in touch of the nation. When I listen, I can't remember the names as good as my colleague, but when I listen to a series of questions, they boil down to two issues, the issue of corruption, actually three, corruption, security, and impunity. I want to start from the Constitution. It's 5 years down the line, the 2010 Constitution. It's a very powerful Constitution, a very transformative Constitution, but we are yet to see the realization of it. Why? Because many of us are not even conversant with that Constitution. Therefore, we do not appreciate what our responsibilities are. The nation is very clear on what the rights are, and that's why we have a lot of people, when they are agitated for something, it will be hakietu, hakietu, hakietu. We must appreciate the responsibility. And the transformation in Kenya will not be moved by the National Commission alone. Your motto says that together we can lift any weight. Article 3 of the Constitution talks about every person has responsibility to respect, to uphold, and to defend the Constitution. If we all took that jukumu personally, individually, as an institution, as a community in the diaspora, as the communities in Kenya, would really transform the nation. Our security, the extrajudicial killings, the people who are being disappeared, those are facts and they cannot be denied. One of the things that is very clear is that our government is very key on public image. That is so important. But we are very weak when it comes to the issues of rule of law and governance. As my colleague has said, if we violate that, we are getting ourselves into a banana republic. And we went there in 2007-8, thanks to this new constitutional order. We are strong as our weakest link. And our weakest link right now, when it's all said and done, it is the National Police Service. We are attempting that through the vetting of police officers, through the training of retraining of police officers, through the collaboration between the National Commission, the Independent Police Oversight Authority, the National Police Service Commission, to restore the integrity and the dignity of the police service from a force. We are way, way away from there. It is very important that we understand that security is so integral to development. It is so integral to our visits back home and here. It is so integral to everything, and we must get it right. But corruption, and you've seen this week, for those who've been reading, and I bet you're ahead of the news, corruption is what is eating the security service. And in our attempt to secure the nation, which is very important, we have begun militarizing the state, where the Kenya Defense Forces are being used more and more and more, and there's less and less investment in use of the police service. And that is dangerous as a nation. We must ensure that the police service actually becomes a police service of dignity and integrity to protect the nation. And that is why, as a national commission, we are investing our engagements with the National Police Service, investing our engagement with the Kenya School of Government, where we have our partnership, so that training on human rights related issues become part of, because human rights is not an option. Actually, human rights should be our daily conversation. Because even what we preach in church is human rights, dignity, respect for each other. So it is not an either or. Everyone has rights. And we do not go to the courts we don't even engage with the courts. Because of the weakness of the police service, the weaknesses in the prosecution, the weaknesses in the investigation, it manifests in the judiciary. And the judiciary can only do so much. It has to work within the law. Today, It is that the Al-Shabaab terrorists, before that, remember it was the Mungiki, and before that, remember the guys of Mount Elgon? Those guys have not gone anywhere, they've just gone under. That is not resolving the situation. Poverty still remains a major issue. We are not poor in Kenya, we are not poor, but we have highly mismanaged our resources, both human and others. And that's why corruption is coming to the fore. And I think what has happened in the recent past is that now people are speaking out, they are more bolder. And the community abroad, you are such a force. The so-called Kenyans on Twitter, these are the diaspora people. You can change and transform the nation by how you engage. A lot of the state decisions are being determined by what is happening on Twitter. And because we must keep our image right for us to be able to work with the other international community, there's also a lot of propaganda coming up and trying to sweep things under the carpet. That is why as a national commission, we are there to protect anyone's rights that are infringed on. We are there to promote human rights so that we can build a culture of human rights. This is not only to the public officers, but also to private agencies. And we are doing what we can with the limited resources and the opportunities that are there. We cannot say that we have the answers to all. Remember the vice chair talked about the Chapter 15 commissions. There are many. When it comes to corruption, we have downgraded the anti-corruption commission. Downgraded it. Actually, as is, it will not function to curb issues of corruption. If you read the March state address of the president, he stood firm. That was the boldest any president has ever done. Stood firm and said no to corruption. An end to corruption. And people stepped down and they stepped aside or stepped forward. But that was about it. Nothing much has happened significantly to move us from statements to stepping aside to truthful prosecutions that can bring about convictions. Unless a big fish is convicted, that's the only way we can begin dealing with the issues of corruption, which permeate in the security sector, which permeate in every aspect of our life. As a national commission, we can only do so much. But as the people of Kenya, as the people of the East African community, because what happens in Kenya will be cut and paste in Uganda, almost cut and paste in Tanzania. Look at what is happening to Burundi. Because remember, we are East Africans. And the Congo wants to join us, Somali wants to join us, South Sudan wants to join us. So we have to look at this not only as Kenyans, but also as East Africans. As a community of Africans, East Africans, we can do it. But we must stand up to be counted. Some of us will fall casualties along the way. And there are many stories to be told. Muraga didn't tell you, he didn't come here because he chose to. He fled here. And he flew back. He chose to. Flora did not come here because she chose to. And there are many, and I can name them. But we must stand in the gap to be counted. We must do it. We must ask those questions, but we must also provide the answers and deal with that answer. We must be bolder than we are. And for me, my appeal to you as the Canadian community, please push forward the government. Push forward your voice. And this is a very delicate moment because of the elections. Elections are 2017, for God's sake, but we are speaking like we're going for elections tomorrow. Hate speech is no longer hate speech. It's the order of talk, but it is inciting, and it's inciting the youth who have nothing to lose. I have something to lose. Many have nothing to lose, and that is the 70%. So help us to work with you. Provide us the technical support. Part of the question about the litigation, there are a number of cases we've been involved to. We've even been stopped by the Attorney General, saying that we cannot sue the state. You are a state agency. But thank God, sometime last year, I think it was last year, the hawkers sued us. And I say that's the best suit of the commission. Why? Because you're saying your mandate says you're supposed to protect and all that, so you're abdicating your responsibility. And fortunately, we joined the suit and we said, we are better off on the same side. We have a right to sue and we have a right to be sued. Not even the Attorney General can stop us. And the court told him so. But you can see the kind of pressures we face in country. Some of them we may not speak loudly about, but some we will. That report on terror was aimed at stopping the loss of life. Just a few months ago, a cousin of mine flew in after many years from Britain, went on holiday to Mombasa after a great marriage in Nairobi, honeymoon. What happened? He's caught up on the anti-terror related surveillance. Why? Because one of them had a dress that looked military and the other one had a walkie-talkie. You know, the ones that you use on taxis? That was a crime. I am telling you, today would be speaking a different story. It took him to be a statistic under the anti-terrorism law for members of my family to begin realizing what human rights talk is about. Because anyone of us sitting here can be a terror suspect, and I am telling you, would speak a different story. And we are not saying the terrorists should be released. No. Today, France was attacked. It was attacked. We pay a lot of money to the National Intelligence Service. We pay a lot of money to the National Police Service. A lot of our resources to KDF. Let them do their work properly, but within the law. And we can make it. We can make it. Patricia.